Hello and thanks for watching Proactive. I'm joined by Michael Crawford. He's co-founder and portfolio manager at Chawton Global Investors. Michael, very good to speak with you today.
Very good to be here.
So Michael, we're chatting about your TB Chawton Global Equity Income Fund. Give us an overview of the fund and what it's aimed at.
We launched the fund around 4 years ago, and it's been designed very much to deliver both capital appreciation, but also, interestingly, it's designed to enable investors or customers who have built up capital to start to convert that into an income stream. We basically focus on companies, a few companies, that achieve what we believe are durable high return on invested capital. And we believe that also where they are asset light, they will generate very good free cash flow. And this provides sufficient capital to both invest in the business to grow, but also to for us to be able to reap a dividend income stream. The fund currently yields about 2.8%, but also we are interested in capital being returned by our share repurchases, and we estimate that adds around another 2% of effective distribution per annum.
Because a lot of companies have been moving towards share repurchases as opposed to dividends recently, so you're agnostic to that?
Yes, we believe that share repurchases are a perfectly viable approach to returning surplus capital. The one prerequisite is that the share repurchases are done at a price which is below the intrinsic value of the company, and that then will add value to that company.
How many companies are in the fund at the moment?
So there are 33 companies in the moment.
And do you look globally?
Yes, we look globally. We predominantly invest in developed markets. So we have our greatest weighting in Europe, including the UK. But we also have around 40% of the fund in the US. And we have at the moment about 4% in Asia.
So in Asia, would that be predominantly in Japan then?
No, it's predominantly in ASEAN. We hold a Jardine Cycle and Carriage, which is part of the Jardine Matheson Group. And they basically own one of the largest companies in Indonesia, which is a dealership for the Toyota and Honda auto and motorbike franchises. But they have a very dominant position in that market and are integrated up into car parts supply as well. So they achieve a very steady, good return on capital and pay out a dividend, which is almost 5%.
So take us through some of the other criteria that you use when you are assessing businesses for inclusion in the portfolio, Michael.
Well, one of the most key aspects for us is durability, which is obviously linked to sustainability as well. So we're looking for those companies we believe will survive, will drive returns for 10 to 20 years. We're not so concerned with fast growth or very fast growth. We think a steady growers can still be very effective investments. We're also looking for alignment. We want that company to be aligned with our interests. And quite often that can be through, for example, family shareholding. So a good example would be L'Oreal, the French cosmetics beauty company, where the Bettencourt family still own over 50% of the shareholding capital.
You talk about durability, and obviously you are a long-term investor. We have seen lots of short-term volatility in markets, rising interest rates, rising inflation environment. Do you at that point adjust your portfolio, or do you just sit it out?
We believe on the whole our companies are really sort of selected on their ability to weather pretty well any storm. So they have low leverage, for example, and very good management teams. Obviously, one place where it could impact is in valuation, and Although we tend to believe valuation is primarily a risk control factor on purchase, we also monitor valuations in cases where they may get overextended. And so, for example, we have taken some money out in recent, about the last 12 months, out of some of the technology areas that we invest in on valuation grounds caused by sort of low interest rates.
You mentioned L'Oreal and Jardina. Other examples of companies included in your portfolio?
One of our largest holdings is Procter & Gamble. Consumer staples are a bedrock of the fund. We have about 27% of the fund in consumer staples. And in particular, the way we differentiate between consumer staples is on the capital allocation, where our management put in surplus cash generated. And we believe that Procter & Gamble, after quite a lot of change in the last decade, where they actually shed quite a lot of their smaller brands, it is now really focused on its really powerful brands. So, for example, Tide laundry detergent is a $2.4 billion brand with 20% of the US market. And what they're doing there is they're actually coming out with variants on Tide. So, for example, they have a variant which works with colder water, so saving energy for their consumers, and also smaller sizes, which still do the same job. So all that contributing to what the customer is really wanting.
James, what do you benchmark yourself against?
Well, we're benchmarked against the MSCI World Index, which is a developed market index, but isn't particularly income orientated. So we also compare ourselves against the global equity, the IA global equity income sector.
And how have you performed relative to the AI global equity income sector?
We're pleased to say that we tend to sort of look at our performance over the longest possible period. And over the period since inception, which is
that's 4 years, yeah.
Yes, May 2019, we are first quartile against the global equity income sector. And I think also, quite pleasingly, we are also head of the IA global sector average. And I think that proves, or it's an interesting sort of angle for income investing that we can achieve that.
Michael, your outlook for the markets, we have come through a rough time. It looks like interest rates may have come to caps in the United States. What's your outlook for the market and where would you be directing future investments?
Well, we think it's going to continue to be quite difficult in markets in the short term as everyone adjusts to the high interest rate environment. And that, I think, is where the combination of growth and income plays to its advantage in that we can still supply a return on the income side. If I start to look medium and long term, I still remain quite optimistic. I think some really interesting developments, particularly in the transition to net zero, which is going to require a lot of capital expenditure. And we have a number of companies, such as the Swedish engineer Atlas Copco, which produces equipment for manufacturing facilities and semiconductor plant. And we think they're going to, over the next decade, see quite interesting levels of demand as we transition to net zero, as various reshoring exercises go on. And I think in the US, it's really interesting because they've had almost a decade of underinvestment in their infrastructure. And we see that changing quite rapidly now with Biden's various initiatives.
And you do have exposure to all that then?
We also own in the US, so Atlas Copco is active in the US, but we also own, for example, Fastenal, which is an industrial distributor in the US. Basically, it provides very small parts to industrial, to manufacturing lines. But although those are small and cheap, the logistics around them is extremely complex, and that's where they add value.
Okay, so a space to watch there. Michael, thank you very much for your insights. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you very much. Thank you.